Now, the Bible says that there are five damaging effects, that when I want more, it brings a lot more with it, not just wanting more material goods. It brings five other things, and they're all in the book of Proverbs and Ecclesiastes. Number one, the first effect of always wanting more is that wanting more brings more fatigue. More fatigue. You're going to be more tired. If you're always wanting more, you're always working harder, and you are tired all the time. Being tired all the time is a symptom of you're trying to do too much. The race to get more drives us to overwork, and we see that constantly all over Southern California. You know, Tolstoy, 100 years ago, told a story of a peasant where his master said, "I will give you as much land for you to keep as you can walk around in one day." And so the peasant started running, and he ran so much and so far, trying to get so much, by the end of the day, he died of exhaustion. And we're dying of exhaustion for things, giving our life. Most people give up their health in the first half of life in order to get money. They give up their health in order to get money. And in the second half of life, they give up all their money to try to get their health back. Be wise and figure that out in advance. The first thing is more fatigue. Proverbs 23, verse 4, the Bible says this: "Do not wear yourself out to get rich. Have the wisdom to show restraint." He says it's dumb, it's stupid, it's foolish to wear yourself out trying to get more things. Because even if you win the rat race, you're still a rat. Now, number two, not only does wanting more bring more fatigue, it brings more expenses. Did you know that? It always costs more to have more. It always costs more to have more. It brings greater expense. You know, I always say that if the grass is greener on the other side of the fence, so is the water bill. Because somebody had to pay for that green. Now, Ecclesiastes 5:11 says this: "The more you have, the more people come to help you spend it." I like that. It's true. The more money you got, all of a sudden you got to have an accountant, or you got to have a housekeeper, or you got to have somebody mowing your lawn. The more money you have, the more money you spend. And it says, the more people you have, the more money you have, the more people help you spend it. So what's the advantage of wealth, except perhaps to watch it run through your fingers? I saw a bumper sticker the other day. It said, I used to dream of the salary I'm now starving on. You know, that's not funny. That's reality. You used to dream of the salary that you now are finding it hard to make ends meet on. And just about the time you get ends meet, somebody moves the ends. You say, "I'm trying to keep up with the Joneses." Well, don't, because they just file for bankruptcy. Now, we think that we don't make enough. We think that's the problem. We think we don't make enough. The truth is, we want too much. That's the real problem. We want too much. And a lot of things we think are needs are actually just greeds. Now, God has said, "My God shall supply all your needs." He has not said, "I will supply all your greeds." God is not obligated to just give you anything you want. So, it brings more frustration, it brings more fatigue, it brings more expenses. The third thing wanting more does is it brings more anxiety. More anxiety, because the more you have, the more you have to worry about. If you don't have it, you don't worry about it. You know, I have to be honest with you. I never, never worry about my yacht getting barnacles. I just never worry about it. Why? Because I don't own a yacht. And if you don't own something, then you don't worry about it. And the fewer things you own, the fewer things you have to repair, the fewer things you have to maintain, the fewer things you have to insure, the fewer things you have to care, you know, pay the taxes on, and all these other things. And now we have so many things, you can't even keep it in your house. You have to buy a place to rent to store the things. Now, what's the logic of that one? You're paying rent on stuff you're not even using, okay? So, more anxiety. The more you have, the more you worry about. Ecclesiastes 5:12. A working man can get a good night's sleep, But the rich man has so much that he stays awake worrying. What's he worrying about? How to save it, how to invest it, how to maintain it, how to insure it, how to avoid taxes. I read a study once that said insomnia increases with income. Isn't that interesting? That the more money you make, the more likely it is you are to have sleepless nights. Why? Because you worry about more. You got more to worry about. Now, if you have more fatigue plus more expenses plus more anxiety, you know what that equals? Number four, more conflict. You're gonna have more conflict in your home because of these things. Because when you're tired and you got more expenses and you're more anxious, you get in more fights. You have more conflict. It causes more turmoil in your family. Proverbs 15:27 says, a greedy man brings trouble to his family. And we know that today, the number one cause of divorce is financial tension. Every study shows this. Over the number one cause of divorce is people divorce over money, money issues. It is now till debt do us part. 1 Timothy 6, verse 7 says this. People who long to be rich fall into temptation and are trapped by many foolish and harmful desires that plunge them into ruin. He's talking about debt, financial ruin, and destruction. Why? Because when you long to be rich, you are a sucker for get-rich-quick schemes. If you are contented, you don't fall prey to get-rich-quick schemes. Nobody can scam you. You're not gonna take risky things because you are contented. People who are discontent are always looking for a way to make a fast buck. They're always looking for the get-rich-quick scheme. They're always looking for the fast solution, the double your return on your money instantly and all of that. And the Bible says over and over and over and over again, we'll see this when we get to investments, do not ever get involved in get-rich-quick schemes. If it's too good to be true, it is. And people who are always in a hurry to pay off their debts instead of what the Bible teaches, little by little, systematically, sequentially, they're always in a hurry to get out of debt. They're always in a hurry to make it big time. They are setting themselves up for temptations, traps, foolish desires that plunge them into ruin and debt and destruction. Now, Warren Buffett, you know, the wealthiest man in the world, his number one rule of investment, you know what it is? Very simple. Buffett's number one rule is this: never lose the money you've already earned. In other words, it's more important to keep what you've got than to take the big risk on it. Never lose. It doesn't matter if you make a high return. If you keep losing stuff, you're going backwards over time. Buffett's number one rule for becoming a billionaire: never lose what you've already earned. And yet people lose it all the time in an attempt to get rich quick. And it's foolish. I'll have to tell you, Kay and I have never lost a penny to get rich quick schemes. I've never lost a penny that I've earned on the lottery. I've never lost a penny in Vegas. Why? Because I'm not about to involve myself in those easy come, easy go, get rich quick schemes, which really, you're gonna lose it. You may as well just go to Vegas and just hand them the money and walk, come home. The house is going to win. Somebody pays for those tall buildings. It's you. You pay for it. And the odds are not in your favor. And the Bible says that's foolish. When a contented person is not lured, ever lured by the lottery, because you're contented. So you're keeping what you've got. And as I said last week, Albert Einstein said, the single most powerful force in the universe is the power of compounding interest. That you set it away a little bit at a time and you let compounding interest, it'll make you rich. Not instantly, but over time. I started putting away 50 cents a week toward my retirement at age 17. And that's why I've served this church for free for 10 years. Because essentially I retired 10 years ago because I don't have to take a salary. Why? Because I had been saving since I was a teenager. And the power of compounding interest builds up over time. It's called the little by little principle. We'll look at that. Now, he says you're gonna get trapped if you're not contented. Now, there's one other problem that happens. The effect of always wanting more is that wanting more brings more dissatisfaction. It brings, number five, more dissatisfaction. You see, we think having more will make me more happy. Having more will make me more secure. Having more will make me more important. Having more will make me more loved. None of that is true. Now, it is true that you can buy happiness for short term, but it doesn't last. The feelings don't last. They go away very quickly. It's true. You can go out and buy a new car, and when you get that new car, you're going to be happy. You can buy happiness for a short period of time. And you'll be happy, and you get in the car, and it smells, you know, that new car smell? Ah. And it, but how long does that new car smell? About a couple weeks. And then, you know, the moment you drove it off the lot, it was less $10,000 than what you paid for it. Because it's not new anymore. You just lost $10,000 in equity, just right there, bam, just like that. And then in a couple years, you don't care about it anymore. Now, this is true with everything you buy. You go out and you buy a piece of art, and you go, man, I just love that art. And you put it up in your house, and it's beautiful, and it looks so great, and it makes you happy for a while. But after a while, you're not happy anymore. And you get new drapes, and you love those drapes, but after a while, you're not happy anymore. Why? Because people change and things don't. Things don't change. So we get bored with them and we have to redecorate and we have to remodel and we have to, you know, refurbish and we have to rearrange and we have to replace and we are addicted to upgrades. And you get a new dress or you get a new shirt or you get a new pair of shoes and the first time you put it on, you walk out, you go, I am sexy. You know, you're looking good, you know, you're feeling good. The fourth time you wear that shirt or that dress, you don't feel sexy anymore. It doesn't even bother you anymore. You don't even think about it anymore. Why? People change, but things don't. So contrary to what you may think, the Constitution does not say every American has the right to life, liberty, and the purchase of happiness. Because when you purchase it, it's not going to last. And, I mean, how many of you are still thrilled with the things you got at Christmas last year? You can't name what you got at Christmas last year. If I said, tell me right now the five things you got at Christmas, name them right now, you couldn't name them. That's how temporary possessions are. They are short-term pleasure. It's a little fix. So what's gonna happen is you're gonna become what you thought you were so thrilled with, you're soon dissatisfied with, and you gotta get the newer model. It's not going to bring you permanent happiness. It's not going to bring you permanent satisfaction. Ecclesiastes 5:10 says this. If you love money, you know, remember last week we talked about money is a tool. You use money and you love people. Use money, love people. Money's to be used. If you start loving money, you're going to use people to get more money. Money is not to be loved. It says if you love money, you will never be satisfied. If you long to be rich, you will never get all you want. Somebody asked Howard Hughes, how much it take to man to make a man happy? He said, just a little more. He said, it's useless. He says, you will never be satisfied. 2,000 years before that great theologian Mick Jagger, Solomon was saying, I can't get no satisfaction. And he's the wealthiest man in the world when he is writing this. He's not some poor guy. He's got more than you or I will ever even imagine. He says, you'll never be satisfied. Living Bible says it's foolish to think that wealth brings happiness. So let me ask you a question. Just get gut level honest here. How many of you would say, I would like to live a life of less fatigue, of less expenses, of less anxiety, of less conflict, and as less dissatisfaction? How many say, I'd kind of like to live that life? Yeah, I think that would be all of us. Okay. You must learn the secret of the law of contentment. Paul talks about it in Philippians chapter 4. Look at the bottom of your outline. Paul says, I have learned the secret of being content, whether living in plenty or in want. Now, I want you to circle the word secret. It is a secret. Most people don't know how to be content. And notice, it is something you have to learn. It is a secret you must learn. I'm going to teach it to you this morning. Now, we are not by nature contented people. By nature, I am discontented. I'm always wanting to change things. You're always wanting to change things. I'm not satisfied. You're not satisfied. It is not natural to be contented. You must learn the secret of being content. Now, how do you do that? Because it's not automatic. Well, the Bible tells us that there are four steps, four keys, four principles to the law of contentment. Here they are. Number one, first, stop comparing myself to others. That's the first step in becoming a contented person. You've got to stop it, stop it, stop it. Stop comparing yourself to others. Now, God made you unique. You're not one in a million, you're one in billions. Nobody is ever like you. God doesn't make clones. He never makes copies. Even identical twins are different. So it's really foolish to think that you have to be like anybody. You can't copy anybody else. You're unique. They're unique. And 2 Corinthians 10:12 says this, we do not dare. He says, how dare you do this? It's a rejection of God. How dare you do this? We don't dare classify or compare ourselves. It is not wise. He said it's foolish, it's dumb, it's stupid, it's immature. Now the problem is we naturally do it. And we do it all the time. It is America's favorite indoor sport, comparing. We love to compare. You walk into somebody's house and the first thing you do is you start making comparisons. Ooh, I like their floor. Ooh, that's kind of nice. Ooh, look at that drapery placement. Look at that TV. Wow, wow, what a television. And you're making comparisons all the time. You walk up to somebody and say, wow, I like the way she did her hair. Mine looks sucky today, you know? And you know, wow, I wish I had his wife. I wish I had her husband. Why are my kids like that, you know? And I wish I had that job. And look at that car. I wish I had that job. You are constantly comparing. And you do it all the time. And that's what keeps you frustrated. You gotta stop it. If you're gonna learn contentment, you've gotta stop comparing everything around you. I heard about this couple in our church who, they were in deep financial problems and they went to small group. And the people's house was a pretty nice house. And when they left, she said to her husband as they're driving, like, did you see that? He said, what are you talking about? She said, their furniture goes back to Louis the 14th. He said, yeah, and ours goes back to IKEA on the 15th. Because we don't have the money for what we got, so don't even think about getting their furniture. Don't even think about it. And we're doing this all the time. I want you to write this down. I must learn to admire without having to acquire. That's a principle of contentment. I must learn to admire without having to acquire. You need to learn to rejoice in other people's prosperity without you getting jealous and envious and feeling like you have to have it too, and then being bitter or mad because they've got something you don't have. You must learn to admire, wow, that's a nice painting you've got. Wow, that's a nice backyard you've got, without having to acquire. Now, this is one of the great principles that Americans don't understand. I don't have to own it to enjoy it. I mean, a lot of times you think, you know what, I like to do jet skiing. So you go out and you buy a pair of jet skis and it sits in your garage 90% of the time. Why not just go rent it the three times that you're gonna use it that year and not have to keep it in your garage? Just go rent it, okay? I mean, you say, well, I like to go camp out in the mountains. Well, why do you have to go buy a mountain cabin when you can just rent it the one time a year you're gonna go to the mountains? Okay? I don't have to own it in order to enjoy it. I learned this a long time ago. I don't have to own it. I just use your stuff. Which, by the way, if you got a good mountain cabin, let me know. I'll be glad to use it for you, you know? Get the cobwebs out for you. I'll be glad to do that. And so you don't have to own something. And you may have a friend in the church who has something you need. Well, just borrow it. You know, don't feel like you got to go out and buy everything yourself. You don't. Because once you own it, you got to repair it. You got to maintain it. You got to store it. And all these other things. I can learn to admire without having to acquire. Now, here's what you do. The next time you walk into somebody's house and they got something nice that you don't have, instead of starting to get discontent and envious, you just pray a little prayer that says this: thank you, God, that I don't have their payments. Because they're paying for that. They're paying for that. And maybe, just maybe, you don't want to put your money there. Maybe you want to put it in the bank and save it and make your money work for you instead of putting it on your wall where it's not making any money. The money you put on the wall isn't helping you. The money you put in the bank and saving is making you money. While you're sleeping, it's making you money. So, this is so important. And when I'm talking to you about stop comparing yourself, this is not just a good idea to make you happy. Comparing yourself to other people is a sin. In fact, it is such a serious sin that God put it in the Big Ten. Yeah, the Ten Commandments. It's in there right along with don't murder, which you'd never do, don't commit adultery, don't rip somebody off and steal. You know what the Tenth Commandment is? Don't compare yourself to anybody else. It's there on your outline. It's right there. Exodus 20, 17. You shall not covet anything that belongs to your neighbor. Don't look at it and go, man, I wish I had that. And you start comparing and coveting. Now, what is coveting? It's a word we don't use a whole lot today. So let me define it for you. Coveting means the uncontrolled desire to acquire. That's what it means to covet. The uncontrolled desire to acquire. And when everything I see and I've got to get it because somebody else has got it, that's called coveting. And it's such a sin, it's right up there with don't murder. It's that important to God. He says, I don't want you coveting. Now, the word covet in Hebrew, in the Old Testament, literally means to pant after. I got to have it. It's the pant after. The word in Greek means to grab or to grasp so tightly that your hands are tight, you can't even let it go. Now, if God ever gives you something and he tells you to give it away and you can't give it away, you don't own it. It owns you. And you are possessed by your possessions. You don't own them, they own you. Now, he says, don't covet. Yeah, you should not covet any. Now, let me make this really clear. God is not saying you should never have any desire for anything. No, no, no. That's not what he said. In fact, that's not Christianity. That's Buddhism. Buddhism. Do you know what Buddhism is? Buddhism says, the basis of Buddhism is that all suffering is the result of desire. That all pain is the result of desire. And the whole goal of Buddhism is to get rid of human desire. And the goal is if you can get rid of all your desires, then you'll never have any more pain. And if you can get rid of all your desires, then you'll never have any more suffering. This is the philosophy of the Buddha. And if you can reach that state where you have absolutely no desires at all, then you'll have no pain and no suffering. And that state of no desire is called nirvana. Now, nirvana does not mean pleasure. It does not mean heaven. Nirvana means nothingness. That's what it means. It means a state of nothingness, a state where I have zero desires, so nothing can hurt me. And when I can get to that state of zero desires, I have entered into nothingness, and I will not suffer. Well, that's nonsense, folks. It is the exact opposite of what everything in human behavior teaches us. Everything ever accomplished in life is created by human desire. Every great city is built because somebody desired to build a great city. Every great nation is built because somebody desired to build a great nation. Every great business is built because somebody desired to build a great business. Everybody gets married because they desire to get married. Everybody has kids because they desire to have kids. Everybody makes money because they desire to make money. Desires are not wrong. In fact, your desires come from God. We're not talking about desire being evil. It's the uncontrolled desire. When a desire is uncontrolled, it becomes a lust. And when a desire is uncontrolled, it becomes a coveting. And when you desire something that is not righteously yours, like I want your wife, that's evil. But desire is not a negative thing. And nothing can be accomplished unless you desire to do it. You can't become more like Christ without desiring to become more like Christ. You can't desire to be a good person without desiring to be a good person. So he's not saying desire is bad. He is saying coveting is bad, which is I've got to have more, 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 and more of what you've got instead of what I've got. So never compare. This is the first key to learning the secret of a contented life. Why should I never compare? Because comparing always leads to coveting. Number two, the second secret, key to the secret of contentment, is enjoy what I have. Too often, we're so busy going after what else we want that we don't stop and enjoy what we've already got. How many people do you know who go out and go overextend to buy a beautiful house, and then they are never at home because they're busy paying for it? They don't enjoy what they've got because they're busy making money to get more. And beautiful backyards sit empty, and swimming pools sat unswimmed in, and all these people don't enjoy what they've already got because they're always going after more. You got to enjoy what you have. Did you know that God wants you to enjoy life? Not to just endure it, but to enjoy it. Life was meant to be enjoyed, not merely endured. A lot of people think God is some cosmic killjoy, that God wants you to frown through life and never be happy and never laugh and never have any fun and never enjoy. Absolutely not. God created it all for your enjoyment. Okay? God created taste buds and then gave us Cinnabon. God created eardrums and then gave us music. There is no single purpose for music except enjoyment. If you believe in evolution, you can have no explanation for music, because music is not essential to survival. The only reason it's created is purely for enjoyment. It has no survival capabilities to it. It is simply God's way of expressing emotion, and every emotion can be created through music. And God gave it to us because God is an emotional God. And God gave us skin that can feel touch and can experience pleasure. And God gave us eyes, and he created a world with color. He could have made it all black and white. It is all for our enjoyment. Sunrises and sunsets and beauty is for our enjoyment. God did this for our benefit. Now, the fact is, God enjoys watching you enjoy what he's given you. Now, any parent understands this. I enjoy giving gifts to my kids, and then I enjoy watching my kids enjoy what I gave them. That's kind of obvious. God enjoys giving stuff to you, because he's a generous God, and then watching you enjoy what he's given you. So God says, in fact, the Bible says in Timothy, everything on earth was given for our enjoyment. That's the kind of God we have, that we serve. It's for our enjoyment. But here's the problem. We're so busy getting more, we don't enjoy what we've got. The second principle, the secret of contentment, is to learn to enjoy what God has given you. Here's what it says, Ecclesiastes 5:19. If God gives a man wealth, if God gives a man wealth and property, he should be grateful and enjoy what he has. It is a gift from God. That is a command. You are commanded to enjoy what God gives you. You need to pay more attention to what you do have. You need to open your eyes. You need to appreciate what God has already given you. You need to be grateful for it. You need to enjoy what you've got. And it doesn't have to be a lot. Just enjoy what you've got. You know, one of my favorite things to do is I put this ratty old chair, deck chair, on our slope. We'd had this deck chair, I don't know, 10, 15 years, maybe 20 years. I think I bought it at Target, so it's not an expensive thing. And it sat in the sun, and it's kind of, a couple of the slats are broken on it. And I put it over on the slope. And what I like to do is climb over my fence and sit in that ratty chair and watch the sun come up. This gives me great pleasure when I do this, to watch the sun come up and just sit there in that ratty chair. Now, would I have any more joy if it were a diamond-encrusted Barca lounger instead of a ratty Target chair? No, no. It would not increase my joy one bit. In fact, there's an advantage to not having a diamond-encrusted Barca lounger. It's better to have a ratty chair on a slope. Why? Nobody steals it. I mean, if it were something fancy, you know, people pick it up. But, you know, workers and gardeners walk by and who wants that thing? You know, so they just leave it there. What I'm saying is you need to ask yourself, what do I enjoy that I never think about it? And I should take advantage of it and I should be grateful for what I've got. Now, one of the benefits of having sent about 15,000 of you overseas on peace trips is you got to see how the rest of the world lives. And that makes you a whole lot more grateful. Because when you've been to the places where I've been, into the favelas of Brazil and the slums of Africa and the barrios and the ghettos in the major cities of the world, you see real poverty. And it makes me grateful for stuff that we take for granted. You know, you know what I'm grateful for? What I enjoy? I enjoy hot water. Hot water. I mean, for me, a shower is a spiritual experience. I'm in there singing and Kay's going, "Shut up!" No, she's not. She doesn't. She's never once said that. She sings harmony with me. And I love hot water. But I got a friend in Rwanda who told me that during the war, he went 9 months without a shower. You know what I appreciate, what I'm grateful for? Ice. Because if you've traveled anywhere in the world, you know most of the world doesn't have ice. And they serve you drinks at room temperature. I like my drinks cold. I don't want to drink a room temperature Coke. Or room temperature water. I like ice. I'm grateful for ice. You know what I enjoy? Internet access. You know, when I travel, I don't need a fancy hotel. I mean, you can put me up in the no-tell motel for all I care. Doesn't really matter but you better have internet access. Because that's my connection. You think about these things and you start being grateful and you start enjoying the stuff you take for granted. You know what I'm grateful for? Toilet paper. You don't know what you've got till it's gone. And I have been a few places in the world where it was gone. And it made me really grateful to have it when I got back home. You need to ask yourself, what am I not enjoying right now? You see, most of us get into this, what I call when and then thinking. When and then. When this happens, then I'll be happy. When I get a boyfriend, then I'll be happy. When I get married, then I'll be happy. When I have kids, then I'll be happy. When my kids go off to school, then I'll be happy. When I get married again, then I'll be happy. And on and on and on. And it's the when and then thinking. Listen, you are as happy as you choose to be. Happiness is a choice. And if you're not happy now, you're not going to be happy later. You are as happy as you choose to be. I could take you to some of the worst places in the world and show you two people living right next door to each other, and one is miserable and one's happy. Why? Happiness has nothing to do with your circumstances. It has everything to do with your attitude. You are as happy as you choose to be. And if you're not happy living on what you're living on right now, I can guarantee you, you're not going to be happy with any more. Because you're always going to want a little bit more. Happiness is a choice. Happiness is something you choose to do. And it doesn't cost anything to be happy. Friday was Grandparents' Day at Stony Brook Christian Schools. And two of my grandkids, Kaylee and Cassidy, in kindergarten and second grade, So Kay and I went to Grandparents' Day, and you know, you go and you sit down at these little tables with these little chairs where you got one cheek on the chair, you know? And you color and you play, and we had a lot of fun. And then we came to my favorite part of school, which was recess. And so Kaylee and Cassidy and I went out onto the field at recess, and we started playing, you know, red light, green light, where, you know, there's a fence which is safe, and you turn around and you say, you know, green light, green light, green light, and you're walking, and as you further get ready, they're coming to see how close you can get, and then you say, red light, and you turn around, and they've got to get back to the fence before you can tag them. So I'm playing this with my granddaughters, and after about three times, I got 50, 100 kids out there playing red light, green light with Pastor Rick. And so I'm walking across the field going green light, green light, green light, red light, and 100 kids are screaming, running back, and I'm chasing them back. And we're having a good time, we're doing this, and then I turn them into a conga line. And we got 100 kids in conga line, dun, 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 dun. You know, they're red light, and they all go running back, and everybody's having fun. I'm having fun, my granddaughters are having fun, the kids are having fun, all of the parents are having fun videotaping Pastor Rick look like an idiot, you know. The teachers are having fun because they're you know, the kids are having a great time. That, you know how much that cost me? Zero. And I didn't need a video game. I didn't need to take them to Disneyland. I was just having fun with them. Kaylee turns around to all the classmates and says, wherever Papa goes, he starts a party. Just being grateful in the situation you're in, enjoying the day you've got. I mean, really, would doubling your income double your joy? Absolutely not. I probably know a dozen billionaires, maybe more, maybe 20. I could bring any one of them in here, and they'd tell you this: money is a tool. Money can make your life easier, but money will ultimately not satisfy your life. Because no matter how much you've got, when you can finally afford to buy everything you want, that still won't make you happy. Because happiness is not found. It's not life, liberty, and the purchase of happiness. Happiness cannot be bought. It's internal. Happiness is a choice. Now, we always think, I don't have enough, I don't have enough, I don't have enough. There's two ways to have enough. One's hard and one's easy. Here's how you have enough: work more or want less. That's your choice. You can work more or you can want less. That's how you're gonna have enough. Well, I don't have enough. Well, here, you got two choices: work more or want less. The law of contentment. I can't teach you these other principles that we're gonna look at in the weeks ahead until you get this one down. Now, 1 Timothy 6 says this, verse 17. Command those who are rich in this present world. Now, let me just stop right there. That's you. Let me put this in perspective. If you have any coins in your pocket, any, a few pennies, nickels, any coins in your pocket or your purse, if you have any coins in a little tray in your car, if you have any coins in a saucer at home, you're already wealthier than about 78% of the world. If you have a refrigerator, you're like in the top 5%. You're wealthy. So get over it. You're wealthy. You're rich. Now he says this: command those who are rich in this present world to not be arrogant, nor to put their hope in wealth, which is so uncertain, but to put their hope in God, who richly provides us with everything for our, notice, enjoyment. Now, I didn't have time to put this other verse on your outline, so look up here on the screen. The next verse, verse 18, says this: tell them to use their money to do good. He's talking about to rich people. They should be rich in good works and should give generously to those in need, always being ready to share with others whatever God has given them. Question: is it possible to be wealthy and not materialistic? Yes. Yes, it is. It is possible to be wealthy and not materialistic, as long as you meet these four preconditions in 1 Timothy 6, 17 and 18. He says, as long as you don't become proud of your wealth, you don't flaunt it, You know, you don't think you're better than anybody else. You know, we always laugh about how I wear this watch that I paid $17 for it at Walmart. You know what? It ticks just as fast as your Rolex. I buy watches to tell time, not to go. Okay? He said, don't show off. Don't become proud of your wealth. Don't think you're better than somebody. Don't put your hope in money, because you can lose it. He says, use your money to do good, and then he says, share it with others. Giving is the antidote to materialism. People say, oh, I'm not materialistic. Well, how generous are you? You know one of the signs of materialism? It's not the only sign, but one of the signs that I'm materialistic, I get irritated anybody somebody starts talking about tithing. That's a sign I'm materialistic. Because the reason I don't tithe is there's just things I'm not willing to do without. There's a word for that, materialism. I'm not willing to do without these things. In fact, God doesn't need my money. The reason he asked me to tithe is to teach me to break the grip of materialism in my life. God doesn't need my money. He does it for me to break the grip of materialism. Now, number three, third way to learn the secret of contentment. Remember, life is not about things. Life is not about things. I gotta maintain the right perspective about possessions, or I'll be possessed by my possessions. I gotta realize none of it's gonna last. Otherwise, I'm gonna be dissatisfied and discontent. Jesus says this in Luke 12, verse 15. Watch out and guard yourselves from every kind of greed, because your true life is not made up of the things you own, no matter how rich you may be. I've said this so many times, never judge your self-worth by your net worth. Never think your value is related to your valuables. Realize that the greatest things in life aren't things. He said, life is not about the acquisition of things. I didn't bring anything into the world. I'm not taking anything out of the world. And the stupidest use of my life is to spend it building a pile. That's dumb. To acquire, life is not about acquisition. Life is not about achievement. Life is about relationship. It's learning how to love. Learning how to love God, learning how to love other people. Everybody knows the prayer of Jabez, God, enlarge my borders. But the prayer of Agur is just as important. A-G-U-R, that's his name. Prayer of Agur, Proverbs 30 says this. Oh God, I ask you for two things from you before I die. First, help me to never tell a lie. Second, give me neither poverty nor riches. Give me just enough to satisfy my needs. For if I grow rich, I might deny you and say, you know, who needs the Lord? Who's the Lord? And if I'm too poor, I may steal and thus insult God's holy name. Now, this is what I call healthy, balanced perspective on wealth. Most people are willing to pray the first half of this prayer. God, don't make me too poor. And we'll all pray that one. God, don't make me too poor. Are you willing to pray the other half? God, don't make me too rich? Because either extreme can cause you to forget God. Wealth can make you prideful. So who needs God? And poverty can make you bitter. I need to remember that my life is not about things. Finally, number four, I focus on what will last forever. I give my attention to permanent values. I build my life on eternal priorities. I focus on what will last forever. And nothing you see is gonna last forever. It's gonna rust out, wear out, decay. Every possession is temporary. So don't build your life on possessing possessions. This building will one day decay, rust, and fall over. The trees out here will one day die and shrivel. Everything is going to vanish. In fact, the Bible says one day there'll be a new heaven, a new earth. It's all going away. There are only two things that are going to last forever, the Word of God and people. The Word of God is going to last forever. The Bible says heaven and earth will pass away, but my Word will never pass away. The Bible says the grass withers, the flower fades, but the Word of God abides forever. This is why you need to read this book, because if it's true, it was true 1,000 years ago, and it'll be true 1,000,000 years from today. Truth does not change. Now, if I asked how many of you believe everything you read in the newspaper, nobody would raise your hand, or watch on TV or the internet or in a magazine. But if I asked how many believe what's in the Bible, it's true, you'd raise your hand. Why do we spend more time reading what we don't believe than what we do? You need to fill your mind with this book. Oh, and there's one other thing that's going to last forever. People. One of two places. Heaven or hell. You say, Rick, you believe in heaven and hell? Of course I do. Why? Because Jesus said it's real. And Jesus is not a liar. And he knows more about it than you or me. And if there is no heaven or hell, then Jesus coming and dying on the cross so you could go there is a total waste. There is a real heaven. There is a real hell. And we are to invest our lives in people and building relationships and building love with them. Look at this verse, 2 Corinthians 4. We fix our attention, circle that. That means focus. Focus on what's going to last forever. We fix our attention, not on the things that are seen, but the things that are unseen. Because what can be seen only lasts for a little while, a time. But what can't be seen will last forever. So you got to decide. Am I going to build my life on acquisition of things or relationships with people? Am I going to focus on people or am I going to focus on possessions? Am I going to focus on riches or am I going to focus on relationships? See, you got a choice to make, and that is, where are you going to get your lifestyle? Because the world is telling you the exact opposite of everything I've taught you today. Everything in the world, in fact, an entire advertising industry, is built on the idea of you got to get more to be more happy, more successful, more important, more valuable, more secure. So you got to decide, am I going to listen to Madison Avenue or am I going to listen to the master? Am I going to listen to culture or am I going to listen to Christ? Am I going to listen to the world or am I going to listen to the word? One will make you dissatisfied the rest of your life. One will make you happy. And you have to ask yourself, what is the primary purpose of my life? To just get more? You got to be kidding me. I'm leaving it all here anyway. What do I think about, talk about, give my most to? What am I living my life for? Just to get more? There was a very famous woman, millionaire in Orange County, died many years ago. And at the funeral, somebody said, she took her life. She committed suicide. Somebody at the funeral said, I don't understand it. She had so much to live for. And I thought, no, wrong. She had so much to live on. She had nothing to live for. You may have a lot to live on. Do you have anything to live for? Do you have a relationship with God? You see, I invite you to get off the treadmill today and adopt God's value system. You see, the myth of the world is you can have it all. The truth is, you can't have it all, and more important, you don't need it all to be happy. You don't. You're as happy as you choose to be. And the secret of contentment, if you don't get anything else, get this. The secret of contentment is finding my security and myself and my satisfaction, not in what I have, but in whose I am. Who I belong to. You find it in Christ. Closing verse on the screen, Psalm 17. But as for me, in other words, as opposed to all those who are buying into the Madison Avenue shtick, but as for me, my contentment is not in wealth, but in seeing you and knowing all is well between us, you and me, God. That's where my satisfaction, that's where my contentment comes from. Being in tune with my Creator. And when I awake in heaven one day, I will be fully satisfied, for I will see you face to face. Let's bow our heads. Are you suffering from the effects of always wanting more? You say, what are those effects again? Well, you're tired all the time, you're in debt. You have added expenses. You worry about your finances. You have conflict over money. You are dissatisfied and you are envious of what others have. These are the signs that you have not learned the law of contentment. Would you pray this prayer in your heart? Dear God, I have been fooled into thinking that having more would make me more happy. And God, I've been so busy trying to get more that I've had no time to be grateful and enjoy what I already have. And you have given me so much. Forgive me for comparing myself to others. Forgive me for coveting and comparing. Help me to find my security in you, not in possessions, and not in what other people think about me. I don't want to be materialistic. I want to be generous with others. And to help me remember that life is not about things, I want to develop the habit of tithing to you. Most of all, Lord, I want to find my security and myself and my satisfaction in you, Jesus. My finances are out of control and I need a life manager. Jesus Christ, become the manager of my life. Guide me in this area and in every other area. I want to learn to love and trust you. In your name, amen.